All right, now that you've had your morning coffee, you're awake and alert. Bryant reminded me a minute ago about this book that I was referencing, this Fourth Turning. Let me just read you it. Here's a chapter called The Fourth Turning Prophecy. This book's written back in the 90s. But they're talking about what we call wintertime. An initial spark will trigger a chain reaction of unyielding responses. That means you won't get over them. And further emergencies. The core elements of the scenarios, debt, civic decay, global disorder. You know, you thought all this stuff was just happening out of nowhere. It's happened over and over and over. Will matter more than the details, which the catalyst will juxtapose and connect in some unknowable way. Now that's two professors talking in words that you don't use every day. But it just means this stuff's gonna happen, and when it does, you ain't gonna change it. They give 5 scenarios about what might start it. The third one on that page right there. The Center for Disease Control and Prevention announces the spread of a new communicable virus. You know, and you think, hello.
Read the rest of it. Read that whole paragraph.
Okay, now I have to find it again. The disease reaches densely populated areas, killing some. Congress enacts mandatory quarantine measures.
Wow.
The president orders the National Guard to throw you can't make this stuff up. The president orders the National Guard to throw prophylactic cordons around unsafe neighborhoods. Well, at least they put it around the Congress. That's a low blow, I know. You know, you just think of politicians. Mayors resist. Urban gangs battle suburban militia. Calls mount for the president to declare martial law. You read that and you say, I thought that was interesting, and I'd forgotten about that. I did remember that. But that was predictions. Now, the way they could make those predictions is because that cycle is predictable. And they could look at the last winter and say, these are the things that happened there. By the way, in the summertime, the big issue, crystallized issue, is culture wars. So what did we have all that era? Culture wars. So anyway, take your Bible and turn with me somewhere. 1 Timothy chapter number 1. I was trying to just get us started by talking about a little bit about reminding you about where we are. By the way, if you're on Zoom, we're leaving the Zoom on all morning. Now, we won't have the afternoon sessions up, but we're leaving it on all morning, so you don't have to check in and check out and check back in. We're just going to leave it. Now, we did mute it in the interval because the conversations here, you could talk among yourselves. But I just wanted you to know, Ben asked me to tell you, you don't have to check out, check back in, and so forth. So the one credentials will get you into all the sessions tonight and tomorrow, too. So just the one set of things. That's for them. Folks on the internet would do the same thing. We just leave the internet running, and we turn off the mics and so forth so you don't hear all the kibitzing going on up here. But you're able to watch. We don't show our normal services, the congregation. We just show the platform, and that's for some technical legal reasons. This property that we have here is a valuable piece of property, and it's paid for. We don't have any debt on it, which means we have a certain amount of liability for people that might be out looking for some kind of tort action. So our insurance company gives us instructions about what you can and can't do. One of the things you have to be careful about when you do a live internet is children. and the issue of stalking and so forth. We right down the street here, about a block and a half, is a safe house for women, battered women who are running from abusive situations. It's a halfway house where they can initial place to go. We have those people come to services and so forth. So that's why we don't, you know, why we do those things. Not just that we want them focused on Alex or me. That'd be a terrible thing, wouldn't it? But anyway, 1 Timothy chapter 1. So where do we go from here? What do you do? If the culture, and Brian said to him in the break that he's convinced that there has to be a major war in order to consolidate all the things necessary to get into the spring. Every winter has had a war, a decisive, all-consuming, world-transforming, decisive. Comes to not a Vietnam, not a Korea, not a Spanish-American war, not something that doesn't, but one that decides the issue. You cry uncle and you move forward with a new regime. And that's yet to come. And if that happens, and it's very difficult to see how the things we've been through, you know, you go through 9/11, people say, oh, that's it. And then you go on a little way long, you have a financial crisis, say, that's it. Now you have the pandemic and you say, that's it. But nothing is actually nailed down. And I have to agree that I don't see how you're going to get out of not having another war. I don't know where it's going to come from. Usually they jump up from places you're not expecting, but that's just what it is. My point to you isn't trying to prognosticate the culture. My point to you is just understand where you are. Live in your ministry in the reality of what's going on around you, but don't let what's going on around you decide what your ministry is. Let it be decided by what God's word is. And that means you need to turn off the television, turn off the radio, turn off the news, turn off as the driving force. And I'll talk to you a little bit later about how to really know what's going on in the culture. And that's the key in the world you live in. But what do we do? You need to know where we are. That's important. But it's equally important, practically more important, to know where we're headed. And as I said, when you think about where you're headed, most people look this way and say, what did we do here? One of the classic illustrations of that is when you do, people talk about, do you guys knock on doors? We have people here in our assembly that go out and knock on, you know, I'm used to wearing a coat that doesn't make me hang up on this wire so much. Knock on doors. And we've done that. But we discovered that there are more efficient ways to do it. So we developed a way to do it with media and electronics and stuff. But there's some people who say, well, that's the way we always did it, and if you don't do it the way we always did it, you aren't doing it right. My point to you is, instead of looking back here to figure out how to do, evangelism is right, soul winning is the right thing to do, but look this way. You follow what I'm saying there? I don't want to beat that, but that's the reason this is important to me, is to try to figure out where we're going and what we're going to do. And I'm saying to you that what's going to happen and what has happened is that we're really returning to a first century world. And if that's the case, and I think it is, I want to say to you, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are books that long on the bookshelf, in fact, that's not long enough, about how to do the ministry, how to engage the culture, how to do all this. And they just all reinvent. And I'm telling you, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. Look with me, if you will, at Matthew chapter number. Well, first look at 1 Timothy 1, verse 3. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge them that they teach no other doctrine. Don't change the doctrine. Don't change what you're teaching. Don't change the word of God rightly divided, the message of grace. Don't change that. You don't have to reinvent a new message or a new program. I've always been, come back with me to Matthew chapter 7. The thing that will make you normal, the big deal is, now what is the new normal? In fact, I thought about, I said that would be a good title. What is the new normal? But the problem about the new normal is, if you've been normal, then the new normal needs to be the old normal. Because the old normal was right. What was the old normal? Teaching sound doctrine. And when you have an assembly that teaches and focuses on sound doctrine, not on the fads of the world, but on teaching God's word rightly divided, making the grace life the central issue, when you have an assembly that does that, you are normal and you're producing the normal Christian life. And no matter what goes on in the world out there, you're going to be just what you've always been, and that is teaching the doctrine. Now, you might teach it in a different, in a certain kind of surroundings or at a certain time, different time, whatever. That's up to you and the situation. I was in Las Vegas years ago, and first time I went to Las Vegas, my son Rick was moving to California, and we drove all the way from here to Vegas in one day, and we didn't stop. And so when we got there, we stayed at a little hotel outside of town, and I wanted to go the next day and meet and see Rena Jaquith, if any of you knew who the Jaquiths were, the minister they had there. And Rick wanted to go to Caesar's Palace and see where there's going to be a boxing match. This is back in the 90s, boxing match. And so we're walking through. It's summertime. It's hot. So we're walking through it. And if you've ever been to the Strip in Vegas, the casinos are open. So they're trying to, you know, get people to come in, and they're air conditioned. So when you walk, instead of walking the streets, you walk through the casinos. Well, we're walking through this one casino, and I hear this, "Hey, Pastor Jordan, Pastor Jordan."
In a casino.
Yeah, and I look up, and it's a blackjack dealer. And he's a student in Grace School of the Bible. So I'm thinking, whoa, that's an interesting thing. See, you never know where you're going to meet your friends. It turned out that he and his wife, she's a dealer there too, this is their profession, and he actually had won some of the casino workers. The workers and the patrons are entirely different people. One is just a job, and for the others, they're gambling. Casino workers don't gamble generally. And he said, there's a Grace Church there. He said, but we can't go to church on Sunday because Saturday and Sunday, we never get off. Our off days are Monday and Tuesdays or Tuesday and Wednesdays. So the Grace Church there, he couldn't get any connection with them. So he started a church on Tuesday night. He said, I got a building, and he's got a crowd of people, casino workers and so forth, because that's their weekend. Now, this is back in the 90s, and I'm thinking, well, see, that's smart. He figured out when their weekend was and put a service there. Instead of saying, well, if you don't come to church on Sunday, he said, I work all night Saturday night. Sunday I go to church, and I'm asleep about halfway through the message, and I can't help it. And all these other people say, so let's have church on Tuesday night. I said that the structure of time, it's not really the issue. And that's what's not going to be normal. The normal is the teaching, the doctrine. In Matthew chapter 7, I've always loved these verses. Matthew 7, 28. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine. When I read that, I say, he had some. You know how many preachers don't have any doctrine? It's all experience. It's all psychobabble. But when Jesus taught, they were astonished at his doctrine. Because you know what he did? He taught sound doctrine. Look at Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. By the way, Brother Crum sitting back there, if you hadn't met Brother Crum, he's with his Pastor Art, you need to meet him. He's the Numbers 23:19 brother. God is not a man that he should lie. And you ought to ask Brother Crum about that. And I said that because he said amen there. Somebody finally said amen, brother, which I kind of like. But Mark chapter 1, verse 22. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority, not as the scribes. You know where his authority came from? From the doctrine. From the doctrine. That's where the authority. Verse 27. And they were all amazed, insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine is this? And with authority commanded he even the unclean spirits, and they obeyed him. They watched what he did and got doctrine out of what he was doing. You see, the truth was the issue in his ministry. Come with me to John chapter 7. Here's one of, I hate to say verses are my favorite because every one I'm reading is, turns out to be that. Here's a very instructive passage, John chapter 7, verse 16. Starting verse 14. Now, about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up to the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? He didn't go to our school. He didn't go to our seminary. He doesn't have our credentials. Where'd he come from? Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. Don't make it you, make it the book. If any man will know his will, if you want to know the will of God, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. You want to know God's will? Learn the doctrine. Amen. Down the hall in the where the ladies are going to meet after a while, it's not on the wall today, but we have these placards, these boards on the wall where they write on, and they teach the children. And they've had for months a thing, if you want to hear God speak, read his word. Amen. If you want to hear him speak out, if you want to speak, hear him speak audibly, read it out loud. Now they heard that somewhere. But that's what we're talking about, is communicating the truth out of God's word. Because if you want to know God's will for your life, you find it there. You don't find it in your circumstances. You don't find it in your feelings and your hunches. And when the CNS gang comes along, the circumstances and situations come along and beat on you, it's God's word. It's the truth of who you are in Christ that's going to make the difference. So go back with me. And let me just say again, you don't have to, you just do what verse Timothy 1:3 says. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. And the key is that you have God's word. Now, when I say God's word, just understand I'm talking about a King James Bible. I'm not talking about the nebulous stuff. You know that. By the way, I don't always say, talk about my King James Bible, my King James Bible. I know some people do that. You know, you don't believe the King James Bible, my King James Bible. It's not that I think it's overkill. It's just sometimes when I hear people saying that way so much, I'm wondering if it's really true. Because, you know, you know whether you believe the King James Bible or whether you believe it or not. Now, we know we believe the King James Bible teach and are sure that the King James Bible is God's word, is the proper translation of the proper text, and it's God's word for us in English, preserved for us. And by the way, Brother Brian's got some books out on the book table. You didn't bring some of them. You just brought the ones you brought that are out there. He's got a number of books defending the King James Bible. One of the things that's happened with the King James issue through the years is it's been poorly served by its friends. And the historical accuracy, the ability to really understand the doctrine of preservation in its application and so forth, when you go through manuscript evidence, I tried to teach the doctrine so you can take the doctrine of preservation, inspiration, and then learn to apply it. And what you discover is that a lot of its friends have had some rather unfortunate ways of defending the Bible that are unnecessarily inaccurate. And Brian's doing a real service for all of us in working through those things and honestly dealing with what's really there. Because a lot of the objections to the King James Bible have been that the proponents were making claims that just weren't really logical and weren't scriptural and scripturally based. And sometimes, you know, when you meet people at different levels of understanding, and a lot of the stuff he's been producing is for you guys, but you need to understand that stuff. And so I commend it to you that you would be able to get it, read it, understand it, and appreciate it, because it's coming from somebody who is, you know, a proponent of the King James Bible, not just a proponent, but a believer, but who also is able to look at the facts. You know, the old thing about, I enjoy sausage, but I don't like to see it made. Well, somebody's got to make it, okay? And when you look at how it's made, that's important too. And so the ability to have that information available to you is critical, and it's important, and it's actually will give you strength and understanding, especially the ability to defend these issues. People have told me for a decade or more that the King James, the Bible version issue is over. And I said, no, it's not, because we haven't won. And we certainly haven't been defeated. More and more people, did you know that the King James Bible today in study Bibles is still the most popular Bible for people who want to study the Bible? It's a fascinating thing. We have people come in here in our ministry here on a regular basis that don't carry King James Bibles. They come from the radio, they come from whatever. But they want to be Bible students. And you know, within 3 months, there's a King James Bible in the thing there. And within just a few months, they'll be in it. Because if you're going to be a serious student of God's Word, and you're going to be a serious student of what the Bible actually says and get your information from that, then you're going to have to be there. But if you have a King James Bible that says, you have one that says one thing and somebody else has it, one says something a little different, what's the deal? I thought they were supposed to be the same. Well, there's some reasons for that, so you need to understand that. So I commend that information to you, because we want to clearly stand for our Bible, but we don't want to do it in a way that raises more questions than it has answers. Okay? Now, that was just a side thing. I'm going to go back. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. If you've been working with our ministry for very long, you know that my whole approach to life and ministry is, if God said do it, then I need to let God tell me how to do it. Paul says rightly divide the word. So I said, Paul, how do you do that? How would you do it? And that's where Ephesians 2 and Romans 5 tell you the time passed, but now the age is to come, and then the dispensations in Romans 5. And you say, okay, then I can take that, and I can draw that on a piece of paper, and I can see it. If you say, okay, I'd like to serve you, Lord. What do I need to do to serve you? And he says, well, perfected saints do the work of the ministry. Ephesians 4, verse 12. He gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers for the perfecting of the saints. What are they for? For the work of the ministry. So who's going to do the work of the ministry? Perfected saints. Well, if I need to be and produce perfected saints to do the work of the ministry, how do I do that? So I start reading Paul's epistles, and I find, wow, there's a pattern. Romans chapter 16, verse 25 and 26. There's Tim, there's a power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. And too many people, I heard a guy just last week, he said, the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret, but now is made manifest by the scriptures and the prophets. And I said, whoa, 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 you missed a word. It didn't say that the mystery was made known by the scriptures of the prophets. It says, and. That's the third way to be established. That's not how the mystery was revealed. And you just leave that one little word out or change it to even, and you screw the whole thing up. So there's a pattern for edification. So now I know how to be edified. I know what I need to do to get myself. So I said, well, how do I do that? Well, I start with Romans, and I read through Romans through Philemon, and I find doctrine, proof, correction, doctrine. I said, wow, Paul laid it out in his epistles for me. Romans is the cross. Ephesians is the church. Thessalonians is the coming. I said, wow, isn't that interesting? Then there's the congregation, Timothy and Titus and Philemon. I said, there's the whole thing. I didn't have to invent that. It's right there, been preserved in the scripture for us. When I read through the pastoral epistles, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, and Philemon, and I think, that's interesting. I've always heard 1 Timothy is the church in rule. I left you in Ephesus. I left you there to teach that, you know, don't change the doctrine. By the way, when Timothy is in Ephesus, this is after the close of the book of Acts, because when I went into Macedonia, I left you there. That's nowhere in the book of Acts that Paul does that. He says, I left you there, teach no other doctrines. And what he does, the church at Ephesus had been there a long time. You remember he established it in Acts 19. He ministered to them in Acts 20, told them that beware the wolves that come in, people internally that draw away disciples after themselves. Then years later, they've had a lot of that happening. So he sends Timothy there to put the church back in order. So you see, here's how a local church ought to operate. And that's why there's all that operating details in there. You're going to know how to behave yourself in the church of God, the house of the living God. 2 Timothy is the church in ruin. All they that in Asia have forsaken me. And the four steps of apostasy is right there in the book, and the four answers to it. In 2 Timothy, you see Paul at the end of his life, departing. He's alone. You think, wow, that's a great way to go out, you know. And I used to think, well, there's the church in rule, church in ruin. Then how does Titus fit in Philemon? Well, Titus, he says, I left you at Crete. You all know these verses, right? Okay, I'm preaching to preachers, right? And if you don't know, I know your wives do, because. And he says, I left you there to set in order the things that are wanting. And what happens in Titus, if 2 Timothy is the last thing he wrote, why isn't it the last one of the epistles? Well, if Romans was not the first thing he wrote, why is it the first one? Because there's a doctrinal progression. There's a progression through the pastoral epistles, the church in rule, the church in ruin. What do you do? Hey, has the church been in ruin a long time? If it was ruined in Paul's day, it's been in ruin for 2,000 years. When Paul left, he in essence said the church is in apostasy. So when you go back and read the church fathers, should it surprise you that the Antinician fathers are nuts? Have you ever gone and read the Antinician, actually read them and tried to find the gospel of grace? It's like la-la land. It's like listening to a Christian radio TV station here, you know. And you say, well, if it's that bad, that's the way Paul said they were. Well, then, what do you do after that? There's Titus. And Titus is really focusing on the church and rescuing the church from the apostasy that it's left in 2 Timothy. Then you go to Philemon. Isn't Philemon such a wonderful book? There's the last book he writes, and it's such this little person, and he says, there, you want to see the grace life in action? You want to see all that the doctrine I've taught you is supposed to produce in a local church? There it is in Philemon. And so there you have the church in review. So you have the church in rule, in ruin, in rescue, and review. And I say, wow. I found four R's that fit that. Wasn't that interesting? You know, I don't have a lot of points in sermons that stick out. I don't want you to hear outlines. I want you to learn the scripture. Guy told me one time, I said, you know, Jordan, you never have any points in your message. That's why I thought I had a point anyway. But my point is that you don't have to reinvent the wheel for ministry. Times change, culture changes, but God's word doesn't change. And let me tell you something. man's need for the truth doesn't change either. You stay focused. Don't get diverted. Sound doctrine is what makes you normal. And sound doctrine is what makes your people normal and allows them to live a normal life in the midst of chaos. So don't abandon that. Don't forget that. And by the way, the vain religious system that is purported to be crumbling about us, it will regroup. It isn't going away either. It's not gonna just because the culture doesn't like it, it's been in the place where the culture didn't like it before. Someone has said, I read an article recently in a Christian magazine. Somebody asked me, said, Rick, why do you read those things? Well, it keeps my blood boiling. It's good for my health. It keeps my blood pressure up a little bit, you know. It keeps me stimulated. But the article said, you must be raised with religion in order to find it natural. If it's not part of your culture and your customs, you're not going to find it natural. And I thought about that. And I thought, well, you know, I can understand if you're raised, in our assembly here, we have Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. If you're under 40, you probably don't come on Sunday night. The people that come on Sunday night and Wednesday night are people, half of them are people that come out of Baptist backgrounds. Because you know what you do if you're a Baptist? Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, or God isn't going to like you. And he's going to get even if you don't. You know, you've been there, done that. And so they're well trained. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. And Rick was telling me, said they have their Sunday night, Wednesday night, they have more people on the internet in their service. We have more people on the internet in every service because we have a pretty big internet footprint. But you see, people have been trained to do certain things. And we never trained. Years ago, the old church, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday, same crowd. That's custom. That's what you learn to do. Younger people didn't learn to do that. That's true, I get that. But the idea that you have to be raised in a religion in order to find it natural, that's wishful thinking from the world. You aren't going to get rid of religious apostasy. It's ingrained in people. It's in the human heart to be religious. And you can do all you can to take away the trappings, but that internal compulsion to know that there's somebody bigger than you, call him whoever you want to because you don't want the God of the Bible, you're not going to get rid of that. And you're not going to get rid of Revelation 17. Somebody asked me about, what about Romans 13 government? And I said, well, you know, there's two kinds of governments. There's Romans 13 and there's Revelation 13. Depends on which kind of government you want to have. Well, there's a religious system. Mystery of Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. Everybody worried about conspiracies. That's the big one. The adversary doesn't care what conspiracy you get caught up in if you leave that one alone. You fight Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, and he'll come after you tooth and toenail unrelentlessly. Because that's the city that rules over all the kings of the earth. From Genesis all the way to the reign of the Antichrist. Mystery, that Baal worship. That isn't going away. So whatever the world out there is going to be, don't think you're going to get rid of religion. Apostate religion, a bastardized form of Judaism. You think about, I've got had a neighbor when we lived over at the house where we lived for 30 years. Across the street was a fellow moved in, his name was Muhammad. I said, hi, Muhammad, we met him, real nice guy. And he's a Muslim, obviously. And I'm talking with him about, you know, about Islam. In fact, I have a Quran. I wanted to read the Quran. And he first told me I couldn't do it because I couldn't read Arabic. And I said, well, do you read Arabic? He says, well, no. I said, well, but he could chant, do the stuff. So how good is that? Don't you? And I went and bought an Auberry translation. And he said, no, we don't use that. A Gentile did that. A European did that. And I said, which one do you use? So he gave me a Quran. It's like a Scofield Reference Bible. It's got study notes in it and all kind of stuff, you know. If you've ever read the Quran, it makes absolutely no sense at all. It's the most, you read it and you say, what in the world was that? You go get another translation and you say, what was that? Because that's not this. They got the same problem. And I ask him, so, you know, we're trying to talk about the gospel and that kind of stuff. And he said, well, we don't eat pork. I said, well, you know where you got that from? He said, yeah, I got that from Muhammad. I said, no, where did he get it from? He said, well, he got it from Allah. I said, where'd he get it from? He said, what do you mean? I said, that's Leviticus chapter 11. He got it from the Jews. That can't be, because they don't like the Jews. Last night when Rachel was doing the signing for Ted, I'm watching her. Every time he would say Jew, she'd go, I thought, that's interesting. I'm going to have to quit rubbing my chin. I said, do you go make a pilgrimage to Mecca? He said, yeah, once in a lifetime we need to. I said, you know where they get that? They got that from Israel, the Jews. Oh. Every religion on the face of the earth has some element where they've plagiarized out of the only real religion, the only religion God ever gave. They gave the nation Israel through Moses. The Bible talks about pure religion. All that isn't going to go away. So you're not going to not ever see it. But the forms. There's a verse in Acts 13 that I just want to kind of, I think about this, the older I get, I think about this verse a lot more than I used to. But I'm struck by what Paul says about David, Acts 13, verse 36. And again, this is not the context, it's not the doctrine, the context and stuff. It's just one of those verses that he says something in an offhand way. But it has a lot of weight to it. Acts 13, 36, for David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was led into his fathers and saw corruption. David, after he had served his own generation, if you could just focus on that, every generation has to reestablish truth for their generation. Your generation needs you to maintain, reestablish the truth in your generation that's been passed down from generations before, so that they then can pass it to the next generation. And just like David, he served his generation and then he fell asleep, they died. He did his job. Your function, my function, is that same kind of thing. And if you can focus just on serving your generation, reestablish the truth, every generation needs to do that. And a lot of times, you don't. You don't make it your own. You need to put it in your own understandable language, your own terms. I don't know if you've noticed it yet, but each generation talks a little different than the last generation. You use different concepts, words, things evolve. You need to be able to speak truth in your language. You need to deal with the issues of your generation. we have a phrase that we've used for many years. We want to provide real answers to real problems from real life. I was in a meeting one time years ago out east, and I'd spent a 3 days talking to a staff of a church of about 5,000 people, and they had 40 pastors. And the senior pastor had asked me to come and teach right division to these 40 guys for 2 days, and then to let them ask me questions for a day. And so I did, happily. When the question came around, one of the young pastors, just hadn't been out of seminary about a year and a half, he working there, and he says, "Brother Jordan, you're answering questions nobody's asking me." And I thought, well, that's interesting. You must not be out there doing very much. And I said back to him, I said, "Well, you just haven't met a Church of Christ preacher yet. Acts 2:38 you to death. Take an axe and 2:38 and slay you if you don't know how to write and divide the word." And he shrugged and says, "Well, I guess that's true." And I thought, wow, there's a guy, and I'm thinking about, you want to answer, he's got people that come with problems, and he was a problem solver. But they're talking about, my kids aren't behaving, and my husband doesn't do this, and my wife doesn't do that, and, you know, had a flat tire on the way home from, kind of thing, oh, nobody helped me, and I don't know what to do, and I'm depressed, and all the little stuff in life, that kind of stuff. I tell people, are you ready to get over this? If you're wringing your hands, don't call me. But when you're ready to not wring your hands anymore, waste time, I got some answers for you. But, you know, don't waste my time until you're ready to you know. If you're just wringing your hands, just go sit in the corner and wring your hands and cry. And after you've had enough, then come on, there's some answers. But you need real answers. But you need answers to real life, where people live. So if you can have real answers that address the real questions that come from people's real life, as Reverend Al would say, let's keep it real. And that's part of it. David served his own generation. Then he fell on sleep. You're going to fall on sleep if the Lord tarries. And serving your generation is how you leave a legacy. To allow truth to be deconstructed without helping put it back together is just laziness, and it's irresponsible. So what I guess I'm trying to say to you is, when you're planning for the future, I'd say the first thing to do is be purposeful. Have a purpose in mind. Have a clear plan of ministry and attention to what you want to do. Come with me to Acts chapter 14. And let's talk about that just for a minute. Because I want you to understand that the local church is the center of the work of the ministry for Paul. A local church is not simply a Bible study. You can have a Bible study on the internet, but a local church is not a Bible study. A lot of people think when they have a Bible study, they have a local church. The difference is, one is a Bible study, one is a work of ministry. Amen. And there's more to the work of the ministry than just having a Bible study where you teach people. There's a whole scope of things. When Paul went into a city, and again, if you want to have a, how do you, perfected saints do the work of the ministry, how do you get to be a perfected saint? There's a design for your edification, right there in Paul's epistles. If you're totally unaware of it, like I was to start with, if you just read his epistles, you'll get the edification, because they're put together in your Bible according to that scheme. There's been a divine design even to put the books together, collate them together in your Bible according to a spiritual pattern. But what's the work of the ministry? Oh, I need to go down to a training union and find out. No. Paul, if you tell me to do the work of the ministry, then maybe you tell me how to do it. Well, if you look at Acts chapter 14 as one example, just watch how Paul does the work of ministry. Brother Ted said last night something I hope you heard. Hope you wrote it down. He said, don't mix the messages. And everybody said, amen, I hope. But if you don't want to mix the messages, why would you go to the book of Acts looking for Paul's message? That's how you become an Acts 28er. You go to the book of Acts looking, what was Paul teaching? If you want to know what Paul was teaching, read his epistles. Okay, there's a progressive revelation to Paul, so there's some things in his epistles that he did early that he doesn't do later. But if you study his epistles, he'll explain what they are and why he did it. If you're looking for his message, what he's teaching, look to his, Ted did it last night, look in 1 Corinthians, and you see what he's teaching. When was that in the book of Acts? Acts 18 and 19. That means in Acts 16, 17, 18, 19, this is what he said he was teaching. So how do I know? I didn't get it out of the book of Acts. I got it out of Paul's epistles. What you do see in the book of Acts is you see him doing the work of the ministry. It didn't focus on his preaching, the content of it. It's designed to show you the fall of Israel, salvation going to the Gentiles through his ministry. And the book of Acts, Paul's part in the book of Acts is that through the fall of Israel, salvation is going to the Gentile to provoke them to jealousy. I speak to you Gentiles, and as much as I'm the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office if by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are my flesh and save some. Paul conducted his Gentile apostleship in such a way during that Acts period as to provoke unsaved Jews to act like unsaved Gentiles and trust the same message. Because God had concluded them all in unbelief. And that unsaved Jew had no more standing before God at that time than a Gentile did. That's why in Galatians he'd say, circumcision availeth nothing, and uncircumcision availeth. It doesn't help you to be circumcised. It doesn't help you to be uncircumcised. That's not the issue anymore, because you're all concluded in unbelief. So that dispensational change had taken place, but when it took place, all those lost Jews out there that weren't in the little flock. You guys got to call it little flockers. I think, well, I think of that movie about the Folkers, you know. I know, too much world. But those unsaved Jews that he wanted to get saved, they're considered Gentiles. In fact, in Galatians 2, he calls them heathen. You say, whoa, how much more Gentilish do you get? But Stephen said, you uncircumcised of heart. You know what that is? He's telling the leaders of Israel, you're a bunch of Gentiles, spiritually. So, anyway, that provoking ministry that he has, but you can see what he's doing when he tells Timothy, you've known my doctrine, my manner of life. You've seen me do ministry. Things that you've seen and heard and seen me do. Well, watch what he does. Acts 14, verse 21. And when they had preached the gospel to that city. Now, what gospel do you think that might be? Well, Acts 20, 24, he says that I want to testify the gospel of the grace. I want to finish my course, which I've received of the Lord. When did he receive that? You read Ephesians chapter 3, and you never get the idea that Paul thought he ever had more than one ministry. And it started when he got saved on the road to Damascus. Now, people take the book of Acts and say, we had this ministry there, this ministry over here. He did it. Paul would say, well, that's news to me. And what did what ministry? Acts 20, 24, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. So the gospel of the grace, he's preaching that Christ died for your sins, buried, rose again the third day for your justification, and that you trust him, God will save you. Okay? So he goes and you know what that is? That's evangelism. You start by getting people saved. If you've had trouble getting people to let you teach them right division, if you go get some converts, they'll let you teach them. Nobody will listen to me. All that bunch of religious crowd might not, but you go get somebody that's lost, get him saved, show him the gospel, get him saved. You know what? He'll let you teach him the Bible. So if you're having trouble getting people to teach go out and get some lost people saved, and they'll let you teach them. You're over there trying to get somebody, some dude in a religious system over here that cares nothing about the Bible to start with. Now, there's some of them do, but very few. And you're trying to say, well, I just don't understand. You understand why he's there. His mind is captured by going about establishing his own righteousness. He's not going to submit himself to the righteousness of God. So your first thing you do, he goes into town and he gets people saved. Your ministry needs to focus on getting some people saved so you have some saints in the assembly to edify. And had taught many, they returned to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that through much tribulation they must enter into the kingdom of God. You know what happens when you get saved? You're going to have trouble. I love this stuff they say. You know, the guy down in Texas, he says, oh, you get saved and you have God's best for your life. Everything you ever wanted, you'll get. He said, I wonder if he's even saved. That's a strange message. So you start off with evangelism. You start off getting some people saved. Then you get an edification process. You start building them up in the faith. You start helping them grow. You start doing what the godly edifying, which produces charity out of a pure heart. So as you do that, then verse 23, and when he had ordained elders in every church and prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. And we said they commended them to the Lord. He's not saying, God bless you guys and get off the grass. Commending them to the Lord is, I just set up a system of God working. You get saved, you get edified, then we establish the local church, and then I'm going to go out here and I'm going to take that message out to other places. And you're going to help send me out. So the local church is going to become a platform to expand out. What's he going to do when he expands? Going to go to another church place, get some people saved, get them edified, get them fully functioning in the work of the ministry, establish them as a platform to do the work of the ministry, and you're going to go out, and now you've got a circle, a model of what your ministry ought to look like. Your ministry and your local church needs to look like what Paul did when he established local churches. It doesn't just need to be a glorified Bible class. It doesn't just need to be a glorified position where you can show people what you know. It needs to be a place, a life science laboratory that's producing saints that get edified, grow to maturity, and carry the work out in the recycle process. That's a key. That's what the work of the ministry is about. It's not about maintaining a look, we've got a building. I ain't against buildings. I love this place. I walk down that hall. We've been here almost 20 years. I walk down that hall still and pinch myself. Said, well, when we left the place in Chicago, 4,500 square foot place. This is 16,500 foot. We thought we needed more room. So we came out here. Now we need more room out here. And you think, wow, you know, that's weird. You know how you buy a house, you've got an empty closet, and 6 months later it's full? Well, we do the same thing. But, so I'm not against buildings. I got one. We have one. But the building isn't the ministry. It's a place you do the ministry. It's a tool for the ministry, okay? The ministry is getting people saved, getting the saints edified, providing an environment that can happen for the family, then producing them into leadership, committing the work to them, and seeing that replaced. And that cycle needs to be in your thinking, which means in your thinking, what are your plans to produce more local churches? Look with me at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Developing maturity in you and in your people to replace the external forms and structures that have existed for centuries is going to be the immediate challenge that you have in ministry. The Apostle Paul targeted population centers because that's where the people are. The last 75 years, evangelicalism has abandoned the population centers of our country. The people are where the problems are. People will solve the problems. If the truth isn't at the table, error will solve the problems. The 50 largest population centers of America are the 50 most bereft of gospel preaching ministries. It's a sad thing. The last 25 years, pragmatism has set in, and they thought the answer was mega churches that reach out to the culture and say, what do you want to look like? And we'll be like, come, we'll be like you, so you'll come here. And they build monstrous big entertainment venues, but that's all they are, is entertainment venues. The teaching is psychobabble. You talk to the people in the assemblies. They don't know beans with the bag open about the Bible. Well, what are you doing? You're entertaining them. You're making them think they can have a nice, sweet, successful life without the Bible. That's not normal. That's not normal. You know what that is? That's destructive. That's going down. Did you know the largest mega churches in America today, they're all in decline? You know why? Because they were smoke and mirrors to start with. One of the magnificent things about this COVID pandemic has been laying bare the falsehood. God is not a man that he should lie. And all those liars out there, can't miss them. They're prophets that can't prophesy. Healers that can't heal. Success stories that don't success. We live in a world, listen, this is the greatest opportunity you'll ever have for the gospel. Wonderful opportunity. In Chicago, I used to think that the African American church was the last hope because they're naturally interested in spiritual things. Brother Art, they have a booth ministry down in his ministry, and we have folks that go there, and people gather in the African American church. You do it here in our area, we have to have balloons and kids and stuff just to get somebody to come over to the table. But you know what? The African American churches completely fail the African American community. They haven't grounded them in sound. So there's no foundation there. And when I see that, I think, well, we're sunk. that part, well, okay, I got that. But where you are, where they are, where I am, you teach the truth. And you gather together a core group of people that will be normal. And when you establish that assembly that functions in sound doctrine, 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 6, be ye followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction, with joy of the Holy Ghost. Receive the word in much affliction. I learned something years ago. First church I was pastoring, I was trying to get them motivated. You've learned this stuff, let's get going. And it just wasn't working, you know. We had a fair every year called a Riverfront Fair. And I went down and I rented a booth and I got our guys to come down there and pass out tracts and so forth. And it was the most eye-opening thing for me. Here I've got half a dozen guys there, and they all know the doctrine. And now they're given tracts, and right down three boards down is a Church of Christ preacher. And they're up here, Acts 2:38 people. And our guys would say, no. And all of a sudden, there's a fight. And you know what? Our guys came alive. You put them in the action. And all of a sudden what they know, oh, and they learn how to use the sword. They receive the word of much affliction, opposition, Now, verse 7, so that you were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia, for from you sounded out the word of the Lord, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith to God is spread abroad, so that we need not speak anything. When he says we need not speak anything, he's saying, you don't need me to come up there and preach. You're already doing it. The Thessalonian saints had permeated that community with the gospel. And Paul said, I don't need to go up there and try to stab yourself. You guys are doing it already. The basis of that penetration was that local church. Okay? So the goal of your ministry needs to be Paul's model. I'm not satisfied until I've developed an assembly that sees people get saved, sees them get edified, see them become fully functioning, mature believers, that I can commit the work of the ministry to, and then they can go out and repeat the process. That's how you penetrate a community with the gospel.